Welcome to Hindu Analysis, July 13, 2018. So today we are going to discuss all these topics. So the first article is China eyes Indian pharma as US trade turns cloudy. So we all know that the world trade war is emerging, especially because of US and China. So because of that trade war, because of that trade war is evolving, we expect that the China is preparing to shift its focus on especially the pharmaceutical industries towards us, that means towards India. So this is what head of the Indian Export Promotion Council recently said. So this is why, because China is now expecting for a new commercial partner, which is nothing but our Indian firms, to fill the gaps that the China is having in its demands, like generic drugs, software, sugar, and some varieties of rice. So for these all items, China is now shifting its focus towards Indian firms. So this is what the recent news is. So why China prefers India rather than other countries in the sense means, India dominates the world's generic drugs markets, which is nearly $17.3 billion of drugs. So this is what a biggest generic drug market. Ours is the biggest drug manufacturer. India is the biggest drug manufacturer. So only China is focusing towards India rather than other countries. India is also a biggest manufacturer and supplier to US, EU, and as well as some and third world countries. So even though we are supplying to a lot of countries, but only 1% of our pharmaceutical drugs or generic drugs is went to China. So this means even though the China is world's second largest market for pharmaceuticals, it is not that much good in or that much beneficial in terms of our economy. So if now China is open its market to Indian access, then it will be a very great opportunity in terms of Indian economy. So the second article is Section 377 and beyond. Section 377 of IPC, which is Indian Penal Code, actually criminalizes the sexual activities which is against the order of nature, including the homosexual activities. So in 2013, Delhi High Court actually struck down this Section 377 of IPC in Suresh Kumar Kaushal case. So, but later it gets appealed to the Supreme Court. But in Supreme Court in 2013, what happened is a two-member bench declined to read down or cancel this Section 377 of IPC, stating that the homosexuals constituted only a minuscule minority in our country, so it is not that much major issue, so we don't need to strike down this entire 377 section of the IPC. And it also states that amending or repealing this 377 should be a matter which is left to the parliament and it is not a judicial matter. So this is what the Supreme Court in 2013 stated. And again, in 2017, Supreme Court state a landmark judgment on the Puttaswamy case, where it upheld the right to privacy as a fundamental right under the Constitution. So in between 2013 and 2017, US Federal Court also in Obergefell versus Hodger case, it also decriminalizes the homosexual activities. So it is a major turning event which also influences our perception towards this LGBT community and their rights. So in 2017, what this landmark judgment case, which is the Puttaswamy case, tells is, so this right to privacy which was upheld in this case is also having four aspects. One is the privacy to space, another one is privacy to information, privacy to decision making, and privacy to behavior. So these are all the aspects which is covered under the right to privacy. So we have that four aspects of right to privacy, right? I mean, the privacy of behavior, that is one of the aspects. So in that right to behavior, that only decides the sexual orientation of an individual. So on taking that aspect and this judgment, which is the right to privacy judgment in Puttaswamy case, they believed that it have an implication for Section 377 as the consensual sexual acts in private can no longer be overseen by the law, which means it is not under the ambit of the law. That is what they state. And the center is also leaving it, that means the center is also leaving this Section 377 case to the Supreme Court's wisdom to decide whether the Section 377 of IPC is constitutional or not. So the center is now leaving the constitutionality of 377 of IPC to the Supreme Court's wisdom rather than deciding on itself. The five-judge bench, which was constituted for this purpose, also states that the extension of the constitutional rights is only to the individuals, irrespective of what their gender is, what their sexual orientation is, or anything. So the constitutional right is open to all rather than seeing into their sexual orientation. So as this is an evolving case, we should wait and watch, because right to privacy is a fundamental right. So we should wait and watch what's the judgment the Supreme Court is yet to give on this section 377 of the IPC. So the third topic is West Bengal to punish communally provocative posts. So recently we all know, or we all aware about the fake messages that is spreading and which led to the creation or led to the cause of the mob violence or mob lynching. So various sections of IPC and CRPC, which is Indian Penal Code and Criminal Procedure Code, it will be invoked to book the individuals who are responsible for creating those kind of subversive and communally provocative social messages or posts in the social media. So this is what the CID tells. So the CID also instructs the service providers for the removal of those kind of subversive or communally provocative messages from the media as soon as possible. If suppose they are going to violate this, then the cases can be registered against the person or against the individual who is the main reason for this provocation of messages, and can also arrest the person on the same ground. So the cases should be registered under two acts. One is the 153A and another one is 124A. 153A deals with the provocation of the communal riots and led to the disruption of the communal harmony. So the cases could be registered under this act also. And the another case is 124A deals with the provocation of seditious matters, which also disrupts the normal harmony or the communal harmony which is persisting in our country. So why they are telling like this is mainly to curb the misuse of the social media and the posts with the communal overtones, which induces, or which in turn induces, these communal riots or mob lynching. Even though government is trying to take various steps to curb these kind of fake news spreading and stop this mob violation and all, there are various concerns on the steps taken by the government to curb these issues. So the first concern is the use of policing as a long-term solution to fight these fake messages spreading over the social media. So policing is not a solution, that is what they told in this line. So the next one is, just for expressing your opinion or just for expressing your suggestion on the social media doesn't provocate the state government to initiate the criminal proceedings on you. So that is also a major concern, because it is a democratic country. We have the right to freedom of speech. So if at all we are expressing our opinion on the social media and they're trying to put the criminal proceedings on us, so it is a major attack on the freedom of speech, which is a basic fundamental right which is provided by our constitution. So apart from taking these kind of steps, what we should do is we should make some awareness about these fake messages should not be circulated, and it should be curbed at the initial stage itself in order to stop this mob lynching or mob violation, whatever taking place due to this spreading of these fake messages. So the fourth article is retail inflation at 5-month high of 5% in June. So as per the CSO statistics, the RPI, which is the retail inflation, which is based on CPI, is like 1.46% last year June, but now it is like 4.87% in May and 5% in June, which indicates that the retail inflation is actually rising. So retail inflation is nothing but our inflation, which is the consumer's inflation. So this CPI or the retail inflation majorly indicates, or it is the indicator of the consumer baskets and goods and services like food, energy, gasoline, goods, or whatever we are using or whatever the consumers are using. So the inflation experienced at the retail shops where the consumers are purchasing, that is what this retail inflation states. So it is the actual reflection of the price rise in the country. So in India, the retail inflation, for calculating retail inflation, we are linking the retail inflation with the CPI, which is the consumer price index. So it is managed by the Ministry of Statistics. So if you see in this diagram, you can easily see last year it is around like 4.88%, but this year it is now 5, so which means the retail inflation is actually increasing. So this is a major concern in terms of the consumer point of view. We see this retail inflation which is linked with the CPI is given by CSO. Similarly, CSO also gives IIP, which is Index of Industrial Production. So this Index of Industrial Production denotes the industrial growth which is taking place in our Indian economy. So this industrial growth, if you observe in this diagram, it stands like 3.2%, which is actually tells us that the industrial growth in our country is declining. So this IIP is majorly based on 8 core industries. So what are those 8 core industries if we see is, so the 8 major core industries is coal, crude oil, cement, fertilizers, refinery products, steel, electricity, and natural gas. So while calculating the IIP, they are taking these 8 core industries into account, and on calculating this IIP, they are giving some special weightage to all these 8 sectors. And specifically, electricity in the last year, it holds the greatest weightage, and the fertilizer, it holds the very least weightage in the calculation of the IIP. So in this slide, if you see, the food price inflation is like 2.9% in June, but before it is like 3.1%, which indicates it's like declining. And the fuel and light inflation is actually stood at 7.14%, which is before 5.8% in May. So which is increasing inflation in terms of fuel and light. So if you see here, means the RBI is projected the inflation of the first half of the current financial year, that is from Jan to June, they projected the inflation rate like 4.8 to 4.9%. So it is actually the inflation rate in the first half of the financial year. But what they actually targeted is to keep the inflation rate at only 4%. So the RBI's monetary policy and the government's fiscal policy should work in tandem so that they could achieve the target, which is the inflation at 4% should be met. But to make this inflation at 4%, that is to meet the target, there are some certain concerns to meet all those targets. So the first one is the impact of higher MSPs. So recently government announced higher MSPs, right? So that is also putting a major burden on the inflation. And also the announcement of state government for the recent farm loan waiver, especially by the Karnataka government, and similarly by some other state government is also giving some farm loan waivers. So these are all the burdens to the state government as well as to the central government. So these are also again a major cause for the inflation. So these things like the higher MSPs and these farm loan waiver and whatever the steps taken by the government which could result in the increase in inflation. So these are the major concerns which could actually resulted in the inflation increase in the remainder financial year of 2019. So even though the crude oil prices is now getting lowered, it is not a major contributor for the reduction in the inflation, because these are the major contributor to the increase in inflation. So even though it is there, it is not contributing to the reduction in inflation because it have its major hand. Topic is monitoring financial firms. So we all know that FRDI bill, right, which is Financial Resolution and Deposit Insurance Bill 2017. So it proposes a comprehensive resolution framework for the financial sector entities and the service providers. So what are the aims of this FRDI bill is to especially to deal with the bankruptcy in banks if at all occur, and the insurance companies and in the financial sector entities. So whatever these financial entities which are dealing with the bankruptcy, there comes this FRDI role. Its second major aim is to give comfort to the consumers of those financial service providers in times of financial distress. It is also to maintain the financial stability during a crisis. So these are all the aims of FRDI bill. During the major banking crisis in 1960, the government of India actually constituted two major things. One is the deposit insurance. 1960 government actually implemented these two things, right? So this deposit insurance bill is to ensure the insurance to the consumers who are availing the services from these financial service providers. So this credit guarantee scheme ensures the credit guarantee to the actual financial service institutions. So these two things are to ensure the credibility of the financial banking institutions if at all that financial banking crisis occur. So after 20 years, like 1978, so the government merged these two things together to form this DICGA, which is the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation Act. So this is also for the same purpose, to ensure the credit guarantee to the financial institutions as well as to the to ensure the insurance to the consumers, or we, that means the people who are putting their money in the banks, to ensure their credit worthiness. The government actually implemented this DIGCA. CGA is getting converted to FRDI bill. So under this FRDI bill, what they suggest is to implement an agency called RC, which is the Resolution Corporation. So if at all this FRDA bill gets implemented and this Resolution Corporation comes into play, then this DICGCA will get repealed. So that is what the government is aiming to do. So what this Resolution Corporation does is, if at all it gets implemented, what this Resolution Corporation is going to do is, so this Resolution Corporation is going to classify the financial institutions like low risk, moderate risk, imminent risk or critical risk and all. And based on the classification, it is deciding on what are the steps to be taken to tackle that crisis which is happening in those financial institutions. So if at all the financial institution is under low stress or low risk, then it is not needed to be regulated by this RC, which is the Resolution Corporation. But if at all any banking institutions or the financial institutions is under moderate risk or under imminent risk, then there should be some steps taken by these Resolution Corporation to ensure the credibility of those financial institutions. So what it actually going to do is, it asks those financial institutions to submit the resolution plan as well as the restoration plan to the Resolution Corporation. That is, the financial institution which is now bankrupted is going to submit some plan which contains the further or future plan of those institutions, that what it is going to do to tackle those crises. And if the RC classifies any institution as critical risk, then the RC is now going to take over that financial institution, and it is going to take over the management also, and it is also going to put some restrictions on those financial institutions, like it should not get any further deposits from the consumers or it should not do anything. So how, if the RC, which is the Resolution Corporation, is now classifying the institution, but how it is going to solve the cases is by means of doing merger or acquisition. That is, by merging two or more financial institutions together, it can solve the issue. Or bail-in procedure, which is very important procedure in this FRDA bill, which we are going to see in a moment. And transfer these financial institution to some other private investor or the public investor to handle over or to handle those crises. Or liquidation of the assets, which is given by these financial institutions. So these are all the things which are taken by the Resolution Corporation if it takes over that financial institution under its control. So as we know that if a crisis or bankruptcy occurred in normal corporate companies or retail corporations, then the insolvency bankruptcy code will come into play. But the same crisis, if at all, occurs in banking sectors or the financial sectors, then this FRDA comes into play. So what this FRDA is going to do is, under FRDA, we are having one major provision, which is bail-in provision. So what is this bail-in provision? So if at all a banking crisis, if at all a banking sector is in crisis, the government is going to infuse the money into the bank to recapitalize, right? So if a government is giving money to the bank, then it is bail out. But if the bank itself taking the money from the depositors, if the bank is going to take the money from the depositors itself to tackle its crisis, then it is bail-in procedure. So consider a depositor is putting like 2 lakh or 3 lakh rupees in their bank account, but if that bank is undergo any bankruptcy, then the bank is now taking some amount of money from this depositor's account and put it in its own account like an equity, or it reduces the money which is put by the depositor, like say 1 lakh. So if it reduces the money which is put by the depositor, and it make use of that money to recover from the financial crisis, whatever the financial firm is facing. So taking this money from the depositor's account and putting in its own account to recover, it is this bail-in procedure. So if the government is putting money, then it is bail out. If the depositor's money is used by the banks, then it is bail-in procedure. So a lot of criticisms are rising against this bail-in procedure, because it is like it rises the risks of the depositors' money, right? But the government ensures that the bail-in procedure is not going to take in very easy manner. So there are a lot of regulations to take the money from the depositors' account for solving the crisis. The first one is mainly the banking sector should get the consent from the concerned depositor. That is, before taking the money, it should get the consent of the depositor. The second one is it should get the parliament approval, first of all, to make the or to take the money from the depositors' account. So these are all the restrictions which are put on the banking sectors or the Resolution Corporation in order to maintain the credit worthiness of the people or the depositor, whoever giving the money to the financial sectors. If you see here, the FRDA bill is suggesting for the setting up of a resolution corporation. So this resolution corporation is going to act as an administrator, resolver and the liquidator of the financial service sectors. If at all this FRDA bill is going to get implemented, then the DICGCA, which we already said, right? So the deposit insurance, that act is going to get repealed, and only this resolution corporation under FRDA bill is going to persist or prevail.